In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
It's wonderful to be able to greet you this morning as we come together to worship here at Holy Nativity in the north of Halifax. This service is currently being conducted in my dining room and is part of our online offering of worship here in North Halifax at the moment. You are here with me, Rob. I am the vicar, and I'm here with my wife, Ruth. That's the other voice that you will be hearing doing the responses during this service. You may also hear Elwood the cat, who has a habit of running around whilst we are worshipping and making a right racket. So they're the three of us who are here this morning. You are welcome in this place. We are going to begin by lighting a candle that reminds us of God's presence here, and we always get somebody from the community to do that for us. It's no different whilst we are worshipping online. We have got somebody who is going to light us a candle now. So now, let's begin by singing together. Our God is a great big God. This is a lot of fun. So, loving God, we have come to worship you. Help us to pray to you in faith, to sing your praise with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Human sin disfigures the whole creation, which groans with eager longing for God's redemption. We confess our sins in penitence and faith. So come, let us return to the Lord and say, Lord our God, in our sin we have avoided your call. Our love for you is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Have mercy on us, deliver us from judgment, bind up our wounds and revive us, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So may God, our Father, forgive us our sins and bring us to the fellowship of his table with his saints forever.
Amen.
Let's pray. Merciful God, your Son came to save us and bore our sins upon the cross. May we trust in your mercy and know your love, rejoicing in the righteousness that is ours through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We are going to have our first reading.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarrelling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat. For God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day observe in honour of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honour of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honour of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, as we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For as it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often do I forgive him? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he begun the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, the Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and his children, and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of the slave released him and forgave him the debt. But the same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves, who owed him 100 denarii, and seized him by the throat. He said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down to the ground and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he could pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their Lord and all that had taken place. Then the Lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all the debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his Lord handed over to be tortured until he should pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father, will you also do one to you? If you do not forgive your brother and sister from your heart. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
I wonder if you can remember where you were 19 years ago. I was teaching in Ryburn Valley High School at the time, and there was a day where 3,000 people
nearly 3,000 people died and over 6,000 more people were injured. And I didn't even know that it was happening. I was in my car and it was long before social media, and I didn't know it was happening until I arrived at my friend's house. I'd driven from Halifax to Leeds and I arrived on his doorstep and he said, "It's terrible, isn't it?" And I went, "What's terrible?" And that was when I got invited into his front room and the TV was on and there were the Twin Towers with smoke billowing out of the top of them. The first tower had already gone down by that point, and we watched on in horror as the second one fell. And there have been many attacks in the last 19 years or so. We had the bombing down in the London Underground and so on and so forth. I find myself in a society that leaves people disaffected. Disaffected to the point where they turn to violence. To the Western world, the World Trade Center attack is one of those most frightening things. It happened where nobody was expecting it, and it happened when nobody was expecting it. And as well as that, it was so terrifying because of the scale of the death and the destruction that it left behind. It was frightening because of its location. Nobody was expecting it to happen in a place like that. For me, I think it's probably most frightening because many of those who died had a long time knowing that it was inevitable. I was listening to a podcast, a photography podcast yesterday, an American guy who was talking about images of people coming out of the tower, escaping the smoke by throwing themselves to their death, and the terrible images that we saw, those people who knew that they were going to die and phoned their loved ones, or the firefighters who ran into the burning building knowing that it might be their end. Jesus said, Jesus said, "No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." 9/11 and other terrorist attacks are frightening because people are prepared to lay down their lives not to save others, but to destroy them. People who are motivated not by love, but by hatred. Against all of this fear and tragedy, the Gospel this morning presents us with Jesus' teachings on forgiveness. And Peter asks him that question. "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times?" Now obviously, 7 is a symbolic number in the scriptures. To the people in the audience who were reading this the first time round 2,000 years ago, 7 symbolises perfection. The world was created in 6 days and on the 7th God rested. Peter is not talking about one more than 6, he's talking about lots. Should I forgive lots? And he probably thought Jesus would like his answer. He probably sat there feeling really smug about himself, thinking that he'd got it right. To forgive more times than is reasonable, the perfect number of times. But as always, Jesus corrects him. Jesus takes it further, 77 times. Possibly even 70 times 7 times. Jesus is going beyond perfection. "Even perfection is not good enough," says Jesus. And then he tells them a parable. A talent in biblical times was a weight of gold. It was 33 kilograms. 10,000 talents is equivalent to 10 billion quid today. The idea that a king would have lent his servant 10 billion is laughable. And hilarious that the king would forgive it. 100 denarii was a different story. It was 3 months' wages. It was a lot of money, but it was a realistic amount of money. The servant is forgiven for his billions, but he won't contemplate the same with his colleague. Jesus' meaning is clear. The sin we are forgiven by God is massive. It wouldn't matter how hard we tried, we could never make up for it. God's grace is immense. It is immeasurable. Think of the tallest person that you know and the shortest person, and now compare them to Mount Everest. Their difference is completely insignificant. Again and again, Jesus teaches us that we need to forgive each other. We pray it every single week. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. We pray that God's forgiveness of us is dependent upon our forgiveness of others. Sin is anything which damages a relationship, our relationship with each other, our relationship with God. God is perfect love. Our relationships with each other and our relationship with God. God is perfect love. When we do things which are not perfect love, things which damage our relationship with each other, those things move us away from God. God loves us and wants us to be in a perfect relationship with Him. Our broken relationships with each other mean that our relationship with God is broken too. For God, love and forgiveness are intimately entwined and related to each other. Jesus commands us to love our enemy, treat them always as we would have them treat us. Compassion, kindness, forgiveness. Letting go of the hurt that somebody else has done to us is what opens us to the possibility of love. And it's hard. It's difficult. I'm not here telling you that this is an easy thing to do. It is very, very hard. It is something that we can only do with God's help. It's hard. We need to have love, God's love within us. We need His Spirit's help. It's the 77 times hard of Jesus' answer to Peter. It is Jesus on the cross hard. Because that's what it took to open the way of forgiveness between us and God. Jesus, who was prepared to go to the cross. In the end, love wins because of Jesus' death. The message of the cross is that love wins over death and hatred and always will win. We have God's word for it. Amen.
So let us declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with His love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray together.
This is my prayer number one. Bless the day that's just begun.
This is my prayer number two.
Make the sky be clear and blue.
My prayer number three, God, please take good care of me.
This is my prayer, number four. Help me love you more and more.
This is my prayer, number five.
Make me glad to be alive.
This is my prayer, number six. Help me when I'm in a fix.
This is my prayer, number seven. Make this world a bit like heaven.
This is my prayer, number eight.
Put an end to hurt and hate.
This is my prayer, number nine. Let the light of kindness shine.
This is my prayer, number ten.
Put me safe to bed again.
We are all one in Christ Jesus. We belong to Him through faith. We are heirs of the promise of the Spirit of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So now, God of life, Saviour of the poor, receive our gifts, our time, our money and our talents, with gratitude for your goodness and penitence for our pride, and with dedication to your service in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, you made the world and you love your creation. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death, and so that we gladly thank you with saints and angels forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On that night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and he took bread, and he praised you, and he broke the bread, and he gave it to them, and he said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then, after supper had ended, he took a cup of wine. Again he praised you, and he gave it to them, and he said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. And so, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and the cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world. So Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy are seen across all the earth. Look with favour on your people and gather us into your loving arms and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. And now, like Jesus taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Body of Christ given for you. Amen. Blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. So now we're going to sing. Let's sing Mystery of Faith.
Thank you.
So let's pray together. Merciful God, you have called us to your table and fed us with the bread of life. Draw us and all people to serve your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you very much for joining us online. It has been wonderful to have you with us. We do have a small said service that happens in person at Holy Nativity at 11:30. It is a communion service, and this morning Yvonne is going to be presiding at it. You would be more than welcome to come. It is limited in number of people who are allowed into the building, so it is understandable that there will be people who aren't feeling that they are able to come to a service in person at the moment, and that is perfectly fine as well. Last week we had, I think it was about 15 people who came along, and it was a really lovely service to be able to come together and share bread and wine together. There are lots of different things in place. If you come along, you will find out there isn't any singing. We have to wear masks, and the seating is at 2 meter distances and things like that. Lots of things that we used to in what is now normal life as we live through this pandemic. But obviously things change on a regular basis at the moment. We've had different announcements this week, nothing that's actually affected church worship, but different announcements about what's going to be happening, and things look like they may be changing in the future. So please do watch this space for more information about what's going on at Holy Nativity. Obviously we are looking at how we use our online presence to worship into the future, whether it makes sense to carry on having communion services on a Sunday morning like this, or whether we should be doing more other things with our YouTube channel. But if you are enjoying our content, please do like and subscribe. If you ring the bell, you'll get a notification when we are either going live with something, or if we are going to be broadcasting other services or talks or things like that. So please do follow all of our social media presences. You can find links to everything down below this video. One thing I wanted to say was a huge thank you to everybody who has been continuing to support the church financially throughout the course of the pandemic. Whilst we haven't been able to meet in person, it has been wonderful that so many people have been so generous, not just with their regular giving, but also in the additional giving that people have been giving to the parish as we continue to look to how we serve the people of North Halifax. So thank you very much. It is much appreciated. Now we shall sing once more. Your love is amazing. So let's pray for God's blessing. May the peace of God, which passes understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, and the blessing of God Almighty, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you, those you love and those you pray for, today and every day. Amen. Let's go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Christ. Amen.
During this difficult time when our church buildings are closed, we're still a church, meeting virtually for prayer services and fellowship, loving our neighbours by offering practical support to the vulnerable, and caring for our communities. The work of our church is reliant on people's generosity, a generosity that is a hallmark of a lived-out faith and a testament to it. We give to our church in a variety of ways, but with the closure of all our buildings, we cannot receive all the gifts that we usually would. So we really need your help now. If you're able to give more at this time, here's how you can help.